So Covenant Love, would you stand with me and let's give honor to whom honor is due and let's welcome Britt Hancock as he comes to share the love of God, share the Word of God with us this morning in the name of Jesus.
Thank you, brother. Yeah. Hi. How's everybody? Awesome. Look, I'm double blessed. I got two things of water up here with me. I just want you to know that I love you all, and the best way that I know how to say thanks for all that you do for us, the prayer and support, is to let my wife say it, because she's awesome.
You're sweet. Okay, I just did want to stand up here for just a moment and say thank you so much for the support that you give to us. For Britt and Audrey and our family, but also for Mountain Gateway, because you support us financially, but you support us in prayer as well, and it makes such a difference. Amen. And we have we have one son, like Pastor Al was saying, who's in Nicaragua with his wife Cassie, and then we have our other children that are serving Jesus so faithfully, and we have missionaries that are in Nicaragua and in Mexico and studying Spanish in Guatemala, and we have vision for other nations. And so that is a part of what we're doing, is training people to go to the nations. And we're also calling workers. So if you have missions on your heart, talk to us about it, because we want to help you to be successful in going to the nations and to do what God has called you to do. So thank you again for supporting us in prayer and in finances. And I'm looking forward to hearing my husband preach.
Amen. I've really been trying to convince the Lord to let me really get a message prepared for today, and I've kind of been in this wrestling match, but we had an interruption in our, it wasn't an interruption, maybe it was to us, certainly to our emotions. 2 weeks ago today, I preached my mother-in-law's memorial service. She went home to be with Jesus a couple of weeks ago, and Audrey's mother. And that's caused me to think about some things. You know, often those kinds of things do. And I've really been praying for you and praying about our time together today. I really feel like the Lord just kind of put it on my heart to let my heart flow a little bit today. So maybe this won't be such a structured message, but I do feel like He has something to say to us all. I find it curious that the thing that I've been consumed by in the last 2 weeks is heaven and heaven's perspective. And my mother-in-law went into the hospital, and she was in the hospital for about 5 or 6 weeks. And Audrey had made a trip to visit her. Before we went down to Nicaragua, and when did we go, hon? Yeah, we went down there in early February to visit Jacob and Cassie and Cameron and Michaela, and help them get settled and be excited with them. And we had some people get saved, and they're in some new villages and doing some incredibly exciting things. It's an awesome thing to go through the turbulence and the wherewithal to go into a country not your own and to learn enough about the language and the culture that those people speak to be able to communicate the realities and the truths of the gospel to people for the first time and have them accept Jesus and begin to raise up leadership, and then that leadership begin to make disciples, because, you know, that really is what we're we're supposed to focus on is to make disciples who make disciples, who make disciples who make disciples. And you and I are the legacy of the fact that that is heaven's single and primary focus. Amen. On this earth. We are the legacy of someone who made a disciple, who made a disciple, who made a disciple, who made a disciple, who made a disciple. And Jesus really is alive. He really is alive. And so we got back from Nicaragua. We were getting ready to start traveling because we're this is really the first service of our travels in the United States for a focused time period to call workers to the harvest and to say thank you to so many of you who help us do what we do. And that preparation was interrupted by a phone call that said to us, Audrey's mother was in an urgent situation and that she needed to fly to Jonesboro, Tennessee on short notice. And so she took off. And I kind of finished getting things ready and I left and I was driving the next day. And those are impactful kinds of things. Many of you know what I'm talking about. And so often we think about those times. And if we really love Jesus, we know that we have a basis for hope in the middle of grief and mourning and fear. There's, you know, none of us want to kind of grapple with those issues. But I'm telling you that there's an amazing equation in these kinds of things that only God can take a concept like fear and hope and marry them together. And it's a mystery beyond explanation or comprehension. It's merely something that those of us who know the Lord experience. And we struggle to sort of explain that and articulate that to people. And we're left merely with the sad attempt to use the language of comparison. And we can't fully describe it, can we? Mourning and hope, grief and hope, fear and hope, sadness and joy at the same time, in the same moment, because of the same event. Who can do that? No one but God can do that. And I lost my sister. I write about that in my book. My sister lost a 12-year battle with cancer, and I've had other family members and loved ones go on to be with Jesus, and so I've grappled with these issues before, but something has happened to me this time to accelerate heaven's perspective in all of this. And you know, we're really... The scripture calls us in Hebrews 12:2 and Colossians 3:2 and Matthew 6:33 to focus on heaven. Fix our eyes on Jesus. Set our minds on things above where Jesus is seated at the right hand of the Father. To seek first the kingdom of heaven and all His righteousness. And then many things orient and line up and straighten up in our life. And so often the enemy and life and current events and news and politics wrests our attention away from heaven, away from Jesus. And when we get our attention away from heaven, despair tries to steal our life. Only God in the middle of death. Something so bad and so sad, and the reason that it's so bad and it's so sad is because it's not original design. But God has done some amazing things. And I've been blessed, and I'm just going to share my heart with you today. I've seen into heaven's realm. I've had many encounters with Jesus. Lots of what theologians call theophanies, and I'm going to talk about some of those today. And I had one the other day, driving to Jonesboro, Tennessee. And we've seen incredible moves of power. We've seen people raised from the dead. We've seen all kinds of creative miracles. We've seen so many people healed, we've lost count. And that's a blessing. We've also lost a bunch of battles and had lots of suffering. And it's those things, you know, we all know, it's those things that cause the greatest consternation when we get stuck in a situation that won't resolve itself. And we can't get the circumstances to change. And so emotionally, I was driving the car, my truck, to Jonesboro, Tennessee. And I was trying to get a sense of where are we in this, Lord? Audrey's mother was a true believer, a true saint, an awesome mother and an incredible grandmother to our children and all of the cousins, and just a wonderful woman. And you don't want them to go, right? You don't want that to happen. And where are we? I've seen God extend amazing power. And I wanted Him to do that. That's what I wanted. But I was trying to get a sense of, okay, you know, it's appointed unto man to die once unless we are of the generation that is so fortunate to be taken at the second coming of Jesus. But nobody knows when that's going to happen. So outside of that event, our bodies all have an appointment with death. And so you don't know when you're going into these things. You know what you hope for. You know what you want to ask God for. And I was driving going, Lord, she had a bone marrow issue, and we've been praying about that bone marrow issue and sort of struggling with that bone marrow issue for 10 years. But she went down really fast. She had a great life. And I was wrestling with God and wanting to know and trying to get Him to intervene. And my son Jacob, many of you have met him, you know him. He and Cassie flew up here. They were in the air and he was coming. He was coming to pray, and he and there was no other option in his mind other than God's going to heal my grandmother, my mom. That's what he believes. That's how we trained him. That's what's right. To lock into heaven. Right? And he lined up people. And he said, if she passes away and I get there, we're going to pray for her to be raised from the dead. I don't care. We are not giving up. And he had people lined up that he knew that could believe with him. And they're waiting for the phone call. And I'm driving. And I know that. And I'm driving. And all of a sudden, I don't know how I'm going to make it through this. Heaven touched my truck. And I saw something that I didn't see clear enough to articulate details. Because I probably would die if I saw it that clear. That's what the scripture means when they talk about no one can see God and live. And so I saw what I take to be God the Father, and he was sitting on this big giant chair. It wasn't to me like a throne. It seemed to me like a chair that you and I would sit in if we were in our living room. And he was up on the edge of that chair. And the look on his face, and he was doing like this. And the feeling that I had was,
I'm so excited. My daughter's fixing to come home. She made it. She made it. She finished her race. I can't wait. And I was flooded with my feelings. You know, now we're just now. I know I look like a kid, act like a kid, but all of my kids are out of the house. I have three grandkids. Two grandkids out and one in the cooker. Do you know how you feel when your kids are getting ready to come home? And I got all this sadness. Now I'm flooded with, oh my goodness, I have a slice, a glimpse of the vapor of heaven. Because you know, if God were to open up his whole emotion, this would kill us. We would absolutely fly apart. So how much ever he figured I could contain and maintain control of my steering wheel, that's what happened. And then I knew. I never, ever before ever felt heaven's perspective about one of his children going home like I did in that moment. I've talked about it. I've articulated it. I know what the scripture has to say about it. I've read about it. I've read other people's experiences, but I can't get over this. That's why I'm standing here talking about it. And then the scripture popped through my mind. I'll read it in just a second. We do not mourn as the world mourns, as those who have no hope. And so exactly what is it that's the basis of our hope? Did Jesus not say, focus on heaven? We are not citizens of this world. We are citizens of heaven. We are strangers in this place.
Yes.
And we'll read it in just a second, I think. I hope I get to it. That we are supposed to encourage one another with these words. Brethren, I do not want you to be ignorant about those who have fallen asleep. It says in 1 Thessalonians. We do not mourn as the world mourns, as those who have no hope. Then it talks about the second coming. And at the end of that it says, encourage one another. So I'm doing the best I can in the emotional state that I'm in to encourage you. I know that a whole pile of you have lost people. But I'm not just talking about this because you know what? What happened to my mother-in-law was not death. It actually was the point where she passed from death to life. And so I was just like, how can you be? I was overwhelmed by God's emotion that one of his kids is fixing to come home. But fully aware and impacted by sadness and grief at the same time. Still, I'm still that way. And so now I'm thinking, that means it's her time. I wonder if I can get God to change his mind on her time. He does that. We do have that option, you know, to get him to make decisions just because he loves us. Good dads do that, you know. And never, ever in my life have I had a greater and more intimate understanding of the good dad thing than I do now. Because he was talking to me on my level as a dad. I love my kids and I love it when they're around. And the only consolation I have that they're not around is that they're doing what the King wants. So now I've got this curious clash of emotions, right? I get to Johnson City, and my youngest daughter, Aspen, some of you all know her. She's been around here some. She pulls me to the side and she says, "Daddy, what do you think?" "I think Jesus has told me this is her time." And her aunt, Audrey's sister, one of Audrey's sisters, had pulled Aspen aside and asked Aspen, "What do you think?" "I think God has told me this is her time." And we have sent out texts because we want people of faith to pray with us. And so Pastor Al and Miss Tava, they were on alert and they were praying. And someone, I don't remember who, got the message to us that the Lord really kind of spoke the same thing to you, right? That message got to me. And then my best friend, he lives in Alabama, the Lord told essentially the same thing. And then my youngest son, David, also had that sense. And I'm like, I guess really it must be your time. And I'm not one who believes that rebellion is in any way, shape, or form a good thing. And I'm not going to fight against God's decision at all. But as we were going through the process, we were able to get Audrey's mother home when it became evident that all efforts were not going to give us the result that we all wanted. And that time at home was the most amazing experience. And during that time at home, I got up because it was going along. I got up and actually I was sitting at the table. Sorry. Aspen was sitting at the table looking at her computer because she's getting married in April and we're super excited. And she was looking at the computer and she came up to the wedding reservations and she saw the spot reserved for her grandmother and she started crying. You know, those are powerful things. And I was sitting right there by her and I looked at the ring on her finger, her engagement ring. And there's a diamond in it that her fiance gave her. And this came out of my mouth and I've thought about it since, but I never thought about it before. It didn't go through the thought process and articulate into words. Words came out of my mouth and I went, I said, "Aspen, sweetheart, all those tears, you know, when you love God and you do right, those tears, they go together. And they turn into those things in your crown." And I pointed to her diamond. And I felt God really come on me. And so I got up. And Audrey's parents, their house, they have some acreage with hard woods. And I went walking. And my sole reason to go walking was to see if I could talk God into intervening. And I was praying and talking. I mean, wouldn't you? The level of your love for someone is going to dictate that. I don't have a heart to try to usurp, but I'm certainly going to ask what I want. Jesus did that at the cross. He didn't want to do it. And he said, "Lord, Father, can I get out of this? Can you please find another way? Can you do this another way? Can you do something else? But whatever you say, Lord. That's what I was doing. So I walked around. I don't know how long it was. Maybe an hour. I had my headphones on and I was talking to the Lord. And I said, Lord, I'm just going to be honest with you. I said, Lord, I wish I meant enough to you that you would intervene and change this situation. Or at least if you're going to take her sickness away and let her go healthy. Honestly, that's what I said. He didn't respond. He just listened to me. He's a good dad. And so I walked back up the hill. I sat down outside on the front porch. And the Lord showed me something else. I had another encounter. This is really going to get me. He said, I want to show you something, son. Because, you know, really, the struggle is, why suffering? Why struggle? Why pain? I talk about that a lot in our book because we've had a lot of it. And when the Lord told me to write, I endeavored to be honest. Because I know about too many books and people aren't honest. They only give one side of the equation. And I'm sure that that's not their intention. There's a limited focus and everything. But I decided I'm going to be honest. And so really in that moment, the root of my struggle was, why does it have to be this way? How many of you ever thought that? Why does it have to be this way? Why is it such a bummer? Why the pain? Why the struggle? Why the hurting? Why the suffering? We've created all kinds of doctrines trying to answer that question, and we're on every side of it. I don't claim to have an answer. I just want to tell you what the Lord showed me sitting on the porch. Maybe it will be meaningful to some of you. He said, I want to show you something, son. He showed me aspen. And I kind of saw into the spirit, and I don't know at what point I saw her. But aspen has a story. I write about it some, about all of our kids. All of us have a story, but Aspen's had a life of suffering. She was born, we didn't know it until this last summer, but she was born with a congenital problem called intestinal malrotation. And that meant all of her insides were essentially all twisted up and in the wrong place. And it caused her pain every day of her life since she was 4 years old. And you know what that does to you, right, as parents? I mean, you know, you beg God, you fast, you lose track of all the days that you fast, and you plead, and you wonder, and you doubt, and you do all the things, and no resolution. And then this last summer, she had something acute happen beyond anything that she'd ever had. Landed her in the emergency room, and that landed her in the hospital, and then they found her problem. They never could find her problem her whole life. Until she got in this life threat and she could have died easily. And then they told us, we found out what's wrong with her is intestinal malrotation. And they opened her up, they took her insides out, they rearranged them and they put them back in. And there was all kinds of adhesions and things locking her down that was the source of her pain. And they cut all that stuff loose and she's twice custom designed. But she's had pain every day of her life since she was 4. And we've cried many tears. Her mother more than me and herself. And I saw Aspen. And the Lord said to me, this was in reference to what came out of my mouth, right? The Lord said to me, I'm going to show you her crown that's growing. Because I've been thinking about the crown of life and the incorruptible crown that we get and the crown that we're going to take off our heads and throw at Jesus' feet, because I'm thinking about heaven, because I know that my dear mother-in-law is fixing to go there. Because to be absent from the body is to be present with Christ. And in the place she's going to, there's no grief, there's no pain, there's no tears of sadness. There's no sickness, there's no disease. The economy is great, and the politics don't have any corruption. Right? It's a perfect place. So I was thinking in that regard, and the Lord said to me, I want to show you. And he showed me Aspen's crown, and and he let me have more emotion. Maybe I just have more emotion because of the life of struggle that we've had. And you know, when you think of a crown, like if you think of a king, you think gold or silver, and it has jewels set in it, right? I mean, that's what I think of. The crown jewels. First thing I saw was this thing about this wide going across her forehead. It was one solid living diamond. It went around her head and kind of went around this way. And then it somehow got woven in with her hair. She has long, curly red hair, and it kind of went down her back. And I could not believe how beautiful. It was not an inanimate object like a piece of jewelry that you buy. And the Lord let me feel his perspective about her crown. So the things that we do that are genuinely honoring to the Lord, and the attitudes that we have, and the things that we go through, I saw them streaming into her crown. And I saw Audrey's tears and my tears. I don't know how this works. And look, don't make a doctrine out of this. I'm just sharing with you what God showed me to illustrate something to me, to strengthen something to me. All the years and all the pain and all the why. God is not the author of all that pain. But if we will do right, it becomes something beautiful to him. Beyond value. And then I thought, suffering becomes something beautiful to God. This is not earth's perspective. This is heaven's perspective. The thing that interrupts that is when we rebel and when we walk in sin and when we turn our back on God and we ruin the opportunity for heaven to make something beautiful about every ash in our life. Because God gives beauty for ashes. But the only way oftentimes that we can see that is if we think about heaven's perspective. You can't see it without focusing on heaven's perspective. You can't understand it. Heaven's perspective is meant to encourage us. And it encouraged me in the midst of my sadness, sitting on the porch. And then that, what I saw of Aspen, it went away. And then I saw Audrey's mom, and she was dressed in light. The light was living. And I've seen into heaven before, and everything in heaven is alive. And the building materials that the place that heaven is preparing for us is, everything is living. He is the way, the truth, and the life. Nothing touched by God is inanimate. When I was a kid, I saw into heaven, and I saw this mansion with wallpaper, and I'll never forget it. Had the wallpaper on the walls had roses on it, and I walked up and I got really close and they were real. Amen. And the gold, the streets that are transparent, the gold was living. That crown on Aspen's head was alive. Amen. Alive. Everything having to do with Jesus is alive. And one of the things that sort of occurred to us was, Audrey's mom, such a faithful prayer warrior to us, and our immediate response was, man, we lost probably our most faithful prayer warrior. And we were thinking about that and talking about that, and the Lord reminded me, no. Son, how many times have you taught that He takes the prayers of the saints, He turns those prayers into incense, He puts them into golden bowls, and they sit in front of God, and He smells them forever, so they don't end. And her perspective now is completely different. It will be just but a moment and we will be together. This life is a vapor. And I can guarantee you that there is no place in existence like heaven. No place. And so I don't know if that helps any of you. Please don't think I'm saying God has done bad things to you in order to make something beautiful. The bad things that are coming, that you yourself do, that other people do to you, that the devil does to you, that this fallen world does to you, that the weather and that all the dynamics that we are in become very precious to God if we will walk with Him. And if we will not doubt beyond the things that we don't understand or that we can't reconcile. And Jesus wants to say to you, I'm telling you, He is super excited about your life. Yes. You just keep following Jesus. So, I had my first vision where I saw into heaven when I was 13 years old. And I've had a whole bunch of encounters that have to do with the unseen realm. And inseparably tied into every encounter I've ever had is God's heart for the world. And our part and purpose that we are here. And you know, Matthew 28:16, it's the Great Commission, go into all the world and preach the gospel to every creature, baptizing them in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, teaching them to obey everything that Jesus has commanded. But I want to read a scripture out of Romans chapter 10, verse 13. I'm going to end with this. It This is not the biggest, shoutiest message today, but all I can do is what I had in my heart for you. It says Romans 10:13, it says, "For everyone who calls on the name of the Lord will be saved. How then will they call on him in whom they've not believed? And how are they to believe in him whom they have never heard? And how are they to hear without someone preaching? And how are they to preach unless they are sent? As it's written, how beautiful are the feet of those who preach the good news. But they have not all obeyed the gospel." And it occurs to me exactly who the "they" is he talking about. Who is it that's not obeying the gospel? So faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the word. We quote that a lot. But that faith scripture right there is in the context of you interacting with another human being for the sake of heaven. We have been given the ministry of reconciliation. You have an ambassadorship, a calling from God. And some of you know that the Lord wants you to stand up and be counted. You know you have a calling to serve God full time in your life. Some of you don't know what that means. You have ideas, but you don't really know what that means. And some of you feel lost. Some of you know that God's called you to minister the gospel outside your home culture. We call those people missionaries. Isn't heaven's perspective the ultimate motivation to respond to the call of God on your life? We're so full of reasons why not. Heaven is the reason why too. My aim is not to try to generate an emotional anything or create a huge atmosphere for encounter, and I love those things. But you, in sober thinking, need to consider this question. Because of heaven, what does Jesus want me to do? How do I engage with the responsibility of my ambassadorship? Some of you are called to be missionaries and you've been fighting it. Or you feel lost and you need somebody to help you. I'll help you. Some of you are called to be ministers in this country. I mean vocationally. All of us are called to engage with others for the sake of heaven. And so in sober mind and sober thinking, I want to give you an opportunity right now to stick a nail in the ground and say, okay, I'm scared or I don't understand, but I know that's me. Anybody in here like that? Raise your hand. Just keep them up. Come up here with me. You too. You raise your hand. You just come up here. I just want to pray with you. Because this is a faith issue. Who else? Come on. Y'all just come up here. The Lord knows that this is a tremulous, turbulent, scary thing. You know it. Now's your time to stand up and say, I don't know how, I don't know what, but I'm going to stand up and be counted. Who else? Come on up here. Some of you feel something and you know you've been playing with God and you're not right with God. And you need to get saved or you need to repent. Anybody in here like that? Jesus loves you. There's no place like heaven. Anybody else? You feel called of God. You feel like He is pointing you out to yourself and stirring you, but you don't know how, or you don't know what, you don't know where, not really. So I want to pray with you. Lord, you say, how can you hear without a preacher? Keep coming if you know you're one of them. That's right. Lord, you say, the destiny of the earth is tied up with human relationships. And Father, you know this is a difficult and hard road. But now I pray faith and courage. Encouragement. Specifics, God. Clarity and vision. Anointing. Gifts and talents of God. Open doors. Healing in life. Stability and faith. Heaven's focus. An undaunted perspective that refuses to be distracted. And an all-consuming love tapped into the heart of God for others. Be upon you all in the name of Jesus Christ, the righteous. Do not now draw back. Jesus will unfold the steps in front of you. You can talk to us. And you certainly can talk to Pastor. Look at you. Look at me. Everybody look. You can do this. God will raise you up and you'll turn around in a few years and be astonished at what you see. But you can't be disobedient. And the Word of God will fortify your faith in the context of engaging with other people for the sake of eternity. I love you. Jesus bless you, Pastor.